السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه والتابعين ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين وبعد. We praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We send blessings and salutations upon Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, his entire household, all his companions. May Allah bless them all, and may he bless every single one of us. My brothers and sisters, a prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was that there will come a time when some people will say that we believe in the Quran, but we stop exactly upon the Quran. We do not want to know about the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, known as the hadith or the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And no doubt this prophecy has become true, and it has been true for a while, where people have emerged who say, we believe in the Quran, we adopt the Quran, we read the Quran, we understand it, but we do not want to know anything besides that Quran. Whatever is in the Quran, we take it. What is not in the Quran, we don't. So Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had warned us that there will come a man reclining on his recliner saying, هَذَا كِتَابُ اللَّهِ, this is the book of Allah. Whatever halal is mentioned in it, I consider it halal. What is haram in it, I consider it haram, and I do not go beyond this. Now, the foolishness of the statement is quite clear, because the first thing we need to remember, the Quran itself was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So you can believe a man when he is telling you that this is from Allah, but you're not trusting him when he tells you this is how it is to be explained. This is the most foolish statement ever. If you have, for example, a teacher who has taught you mathematics or physics or anything else, and you are to take it from that particular teacher, known as an honest, upright person, a person who definitely has brought what has resulted in the success of so many people before you in those examinations, and then we say, no, I am only going to select this portion of what they've said, and the rest of it, I don't trust them in it. I don't want to believe them in it. Astaghfirullah. This is such a foolish statement. But the reality is, the number of these people seems to be growing, or their voice seems to be coming louder and louder. And for this reason, it is up to us to make clear that we believe not only in the Quran, but in the explanation given by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the life that he lived. Every statement of his is sacred. Every movement of his is sacred. Every explanation of his is sacred. The confirmations of his were absolutely sacred. This is part and parcel of the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And this is why, if you recall, last week I made mention of something important when we spoke about the Quran. And what I said is, if we were to follow the Quran correctly, it would lead us to the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Clearly Allah says, وَمَا آتَاكُمُ الرَّسُولُ فَخُذُوهُ وَمَا نَهَاكُمْ عَنْهُ فَانْتَهُوا, that which the messenger has given you, he has instructed you, consider it an instruction, and that which he has prohibited you from, consider it as a prohibition. Why would Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala say this? Not only that, that verse itself was brought by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It came to us through him. So we believe the man when it comes to telling us that this is the part of the Quran, but we don't want to understand the meaning of the same verse. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. In another instance, when it comes to disputes amongst the believers, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was instructed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The verse came through Jibreel alayhi salatu wa salam to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, conveyed to us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and we believe completely, in fact, even those who do not adopt the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, or who reject the hadith, they confirm that this is a verse of the Quran. What is the verse? فَلَا وَرَبِّكَ لَا يُؤْمِنُونَ حَتَّى يُحَكِّمُوكَ فِي مَا شَجَرَ بَيْنَهُمْ ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا ثُمَّ لَا يَجِدُوا فِي أَنفُسِهِمْ حَرَجًا مِمَّا قَضَيْتَ وَيُسَلِّمُوا تَسْلِيمًا. Nay, they are not considered true believers until they make you the judge in whatever disputes they have, amongst them. And once the decision that you have given has been made clear to them, they will not find in their hearts even a single droplet of animosity towards that particular decision. And those are the believers. So a description of the believers, those whom, when they have a dispute amongst them, they make a ruling based on what was taught by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. This verse says, if they do not do that, they cannot call themselves true believers. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. And on top of that, once the decision has been made, whether it is for us or against us, it is made upon justice, upon the teachings of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. In our hearts, we are not allowed to feel, even in the least, that we've lost something. In fact, it is only a win-win situation, because we would be adopting the Sharia, we would be adopting the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala regarding the disputes amongst us. And that alone is a win. That itself is already a win. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala help us and guide us. And for this reason, you find in Surah Al-Ahzab, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says it in different words. Again, these words were brought to us by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We trust him when he told us that this is from Allah. So we trust him when he tells us that this is how the explanation is. Subhanallah. Quite simple, quite logical. What is the verse? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَمَا كَانَ لِمُؤْمِنٍ وَلَا مُؤْمِنَةٍ إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُهُ أَمْرًا أَنْ يَكُونَ لَهُمُ الْخِيَرَةُ مِنْ أَمْرِهِمْ وَمَنْ يَعْصِ اللَّهَ وَرَسُولَهُ فَقَدْ ضَلَّ ضَلَالًا مُبِينًا. It is not befitting for a true believing male or female that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the messenger, peace be upon him, have decided something, declared something, passed something, that they feel in their hearts that we still have a choice in this regard. The decision has been made. So the true believers feel we have no longer a choice in this regard. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, whoever disobeys Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and whoever disobeys the messenger, may peace be upon him, they have indeed gone astray quite clearly, quite openly. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us from going astray. So, in fact, if we were to move a little bit further, we would also come to the explanation of all the basic pillars of Islam. Let's take a look at the five pillars. When it comes to, for example, Salah, the prayer that we have five times a day. Yes, the Quran has instructed us in brief to fulfill the prayer, but it has not explained to us the details of the ruku' and what to read in it and the sujood and how to get up and to read Surah Al-Fatiha in the first rak'ah or in the rak'at, the units of salah, and what to do exactly thereafter, and for example in the third and the fourth rak'at of a farad or a compulsory prayer, and the precise timings and so on. Precise explanation given by Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So those who discount or do not believe in the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are actually eradicating Islam. They are slowly trying to delete the rules of Islam. So they will come to prayer and they will say, well, you don't need to prostrate because that's not obligatory, because it's not in the Quran. And they might even say, you don't need to read salah, you don't need to read Quran when it comes to salah, because it doesn't mention that in the Quran. They will probably even say, you don't need to pray five times a day because the five times a day is not mentioned in the Quran. But these are pillars of Islam that are necessary in order to enter into the fold of Islam. How then can we dispute them? So it's common logic, common knowledge and common sense that subhanallah, the explanation of the messenger is the most powerful and the only reliable explanation that is after the revelation of the Quran. And this is why Allah says in the beginning of Surah An-Najm, وَالنَّجْمِ إِذَا هَوَى مَا ضَلَّ صَاحِبُكُمْ وَمَا غَوَى وَمَا يَنطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَى إِنْ هُوَ إِلَّا وَحْيٌ يُوحَى. Allah is taking an oath by the stars, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, your companion, meaning the messenger, ma yantiqu anil hawa. Firstly, he is not astray. Ma dalla sahibukum wa ma ghawa. He is not astray, he has not faltered in any way. And then Allah says, wa ma yantiqu anil hawa. He does not utter any utterance from his own whims and fancies or desires, na'udhu billah. But Allah says, in huwa illa wahyun yuha. It is none, which means his utterances are none other than revelation inspired by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is why I started by saying the statements of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam are sacred. They are recorded. And people might argue and say, well, you know, the hadith came about 150 years after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Such people have not given it a thought. They have not even pondered for a minute. The fallacy in their statement is quite manifest and clear. It shows their ignorance. Because you and I know that technology progresses. The system of memorization has changed from time to time. A few years ago, we all memorized so many phone numbers because there was no system that did the job for us. I knew perhaps 100 numbers and even more, and long international phone numbers, and I'm sure a lot of us did the same. But then comes the mobile, and what did it do? It made us lazy to the degree that I don't even think we know our own spouse's numbers sometimes, let alone our own. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So if someone says, well, you know what, why didn't they have it in the first place in the mobile phone? We would tell them the mobile phone did not exist at the time. So you are foolish to say that why was it not recorded in the computer chip or on a CD or perhaps on the computer and what have you, the memory chips and so on. We would tell them that did not exist some time back, but we relied on memory. And it was quite simple. We did not really make blunders when it came to important phone numbers. People had to tell it to you once, and you memorized it because you knew that this is a very important number. So at the time of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, you and I know that Allah says,
هُوَ الَّذِي بَعَثَ فِي الْأُمِّيِّينَ رَسُولًا مِّنْهُمْ.
Allah has sent to the nation who were mostly unlettered a messenger from amongst them. Unlettered meaning they were not into reading and writing at the time. Very few people could actually read and write. So it was not considered something bad, but it was considered an honor and a privilege if someone could read and write. It was not considered bad if they could not, but if they did, it was considered a privilege. They were looked at a handful of people. And this is why people relied on memory such that the books have made mention of how they knew their lineage up to 15, 20 generations back, their lineage. If you are to ask what is the lineage of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, the books would make mention of his lineage going all the way back even to Ibrahim alayhi salam and beyond. And with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it would go right back even to Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. So this is something that they knew, it was in their heads. They had it, that was the in thing. The gigabytes in their heads were being utilized. Unlike us, we don't even know if there's a gigabyte up there. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. It's been replaced by a small nail size, the size of a nail, a chip. And then we want to start saying, why did they record the hadith 150 years later or 100 years later, a century later? Common logic, they had it in memory, they knew it. The day everyone started reading and writing, and the day they started losing a few of those who had memorized it, they then began to gather. They gathered the Quran together. They gathered the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam together. They put it down. And trust me, as soon as the next technology or the next latest came out, it was transferred to that. So much so that today you have the Quran on your phone and on the apps, and you have it on every small little item, including the iClouds and whatnot. You can download it anytime, anywhere you are on the globe. It would be foolish for us to say, well, I'm not going to believe in it because this iCloud did not exist 100 years back. Well, the foolish person is he who makes such utterances without thinking. And this is why there is no doubt in the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was recorded. The Quran was recorded first because obviously it's the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And thereafter came the recording of the Sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And for your information, it was recorded with such precision that every person who claimed to have a narration of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam's or a movement of his that was recorded. Remember this, something sacred. If Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam moved his head, it was sacred. It was recorded. They remembered it. On this occasion, he put up two fingers. Subhanallah. That's how sacred his entire life was. And Allah says it quite clearly.
لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ.
Indeed, for you, there is a powerful, beautiful
example to emulate in that of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You want to live a life of goodness, you want to be happy and content. Well, here is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. His entire life has been recorded with greatest of precision. Follow it and you find success in this world and the next. So, subhanallah, like I said, technology progressed and the recording progressed. We are utilizing today as Muslimin something that was never utilized before. Trust me, next year, if something new comes up, we will be using it again. Do you recall the days of the ordinary cassettes, the audio cassettes? Some might still have an audio player. Today, try and tell the youngsters, we have a cassette. They have actually told me, what is that? We have to now explain to them what it is. You know, there was a cassette with a little bit of a ribbon and so on. Subhanallah, technology has progressed such that very soon we won't even be using CDs. That does not mean that we find error in what was recorded from the time of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the point I was raising, everyone who claimed to have even a little bit of what Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life had in it, had to present their credentials. Who are you? Where did you learn from? What happened? And where are the witnesses or the people who know you? And people would know that this man definitely heard from such a person, who heard from such a person, and they heard from Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or they met him. If there was a discrepancy in the meeting, it was discounted, meaning their narration was discounted. If there was a discrepancy in the wording, for example, and some had to dispute it, it was discounted, and so on. To this day, it is quite easy to distinguish between narrations that are correct and authentic and those which are fabricated. It is quite easy for those who would like to learn. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the minimum, and that is the adoption of whatever we know of the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the fact that we believe in the Quran as well as the sunnah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And obviously we also believe that there is an explanation of the Sahaba radiallahu anhum that is of utmost importance. Wherever we don't find that which is self-explanatory in the hadith or in the Quran, it's important for us to ask those with knowledge. And this is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, فَاسْأَلُوا أَهْلَ الذِّكْرِ إِن كُنتُمْ لَا تَعْلَمُونَ بِالْبَيِّنَاتِ وَالزُّبُرِ. Ask those who have knowledge. Ask those who have the remembrance, who have knowledge. If you are uncertain regarding revelation that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed and the clear-cut signs or the verses. So we are to ask those with knowledge in order to get an answer. Now I have a question, and that is, if you are to ask a knowledgeable man in your midst regarding a religious issue that you have a question about and you would trust him, surely we would have to trust Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There is no comparison between the two. People are ready to trust a man who is in their midst today when he tells them this is how you should read salah, and they are telling you that we are not going to adopt the hadith. Come on, subhanallah. The man who came with the revelation, we want to discount what he said. And the person you are asking in front of you generations later, you want to adopt what he is now coming to say. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. So there is a lot that would prove that the error in the statement of those who would like to find fault in the hadith of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And I've chosen this day very importantly because we have now entered the month of Dhul-Hijjah, a very important month. It is important for us to increase our ibadah. It is important for us to try our best to gain closeness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The hadith says, مَا مِنْ أَيَّامٍ الْعَمَلُ الصَّالِحُ فِيهِنَّ أَحَبَّ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِنْ هَذِهِ الْعَشْرِ. There are no days of the year wherein good deeds are more loved by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than these 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. So you want to do good deeds? Do a lot of good deeds. Your kindness to your family, to everyone else, your goodness, your salah, your extra ibadat, if you would like to fast and so on, the reward of fasting on the day of Arafah, which is the 9th day of Dhul-Hijjah, the reward is such that you would have the forgiveness of sins committed in the past year. And one narration says even in the coming year or the present year. How powerful is this? But there are people who find fault in these narrations because they say, look, I adopt the Quran, but there's nothing mentioned about this in the Quran. Well, as I've started, I would like to end by saying, if that is the case, it is as good as saying I'm not following Islam. Because the Quran, yes, as much as everything has been made clear in the Quran, through the the explanation of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam in the hadith and in his statements. He was the living example. And this is why Aisha radiallahu anha was asked once that, tell us about the character of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Do you know what she said? This hadith is in Sahih al-Bukhari, hadith of Aisha radiallahu anha. She says, "Kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an." Imagine if I were to ask you, what is this man's character? Can you please tell me more about it? We would expect someone to sit down and to explain to us, you know, he did this and he did that. She had one word. She said his character was the Quran. He was a living Quran, subhanallah, which means he knew best how to fulfill it. So we need to take from that. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all and grant us all goodness. May he grant us forgiveness in these beautiful days. My brothers and sisters, spend a moment. Today is a Friday. It is Dhul Hijjah. It is a powerful month. It is actually the month of Hajj. Believe me, it is about time we spent moments to look into our hearts, to remove hatred, jealousy, enmity, envy, whatever dirty qualities we have, take them out. Learn to love one another for the sake of Allah. We may have differences, we may have a few disputes, but that should not undermine the connection we have for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's about time we rekindle the brotherhood of Islam, the sisterhood of Islam. These petties mean nothing. Let's get to the akhirah. If Allah is happy with us and pleased with us, inshallah we will be granted Jannah. May Allah grant that to us. Wa sallallahu wa sallama wa baraka ala nabina Muhammad.